Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.
Very good.
Hi, welcome to Talking Mental Health. I'm Jim Miller. Today we're going to be talking to my guest, Bob Scheffler. He is the CEO of Haven Behavioral Hospital right here in Reading. And I brought him on for a few reasons. He is about new in town, 4 months.
Newish, yep.
Newish. And besides his work at the hospital, he's very much an advocate for people with mental illness. He's very much, for instance, into anti-stigma campaigns and things like that. So we'll be spending our time talking about Haven, the hospital, and then we'll spend some time talking about anti-stigma and other things, perhaps suicide prevention. I know you're on the countywide board that's looking into that. So Bob's been in this field for over 20 years. He's worked with rural populations. He's a social worker by training. But we're just so glad that you landed here in Reading.
Thank you.
Let's talk about psychiatric hospitals in general, because, you know, lots of times on this show and our guests, we talk about outpatient programs and things like that. So why don't you tell us how the psychiatric hospital today, you know, fits into the continuum of care? What is your role as a hospital?
Sure, and I'm glad you asked, because psychiatric hospitals are one of those hidden things in the field. Mm-hmm. You know, we talk about all the time how people within our field who make referrals, mm-hmm. Of course, lay people who don't have much contact with the field whatsoever and might have peripheral contact really don't know what happens in psychiatric hospitals. And, you know, we don't have much of a frame of reference. We have movies, we have TVs, that type of thing. But really, you know, most people's frame of reference is medical surgical hospitals. We all know what
right,
those are like.
Sure.
We can walk in them. You and I right now could go down to the local hospital, walk right in, go up, walk in a patient's room, go right up to the nursing station. We can get a feel for that.
Yeah.
Psychiatric hospitals, for very good reason, are closed off. We're locked. We don't have people wandering through. We control access for a couple really good reasons. Patients deserve their privacy. Privacy is an absolutely sacred thing in our field. You deserve the right to be sick and to not be judged by that. And you deserve the right to be sick and not have people gawking at you. So
Right. Very
similar to how, you know, a woman giving birth doesn't want random visitors in the room during
right.
that process.
Right.
People who are sick with mental illness should have the right to have privacy, because at the heart of their most acute illness, there may be things that they do and say that they don't want the world to see, and that might be embarrassing. And when they get better, they might want to just be able to leave that. And that's something that's very important. So we do keep it closed off for those reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But the downside of keeping it closed off is that most people have no frame of reference of what happens in there.
Right.
And our mind can go all kinds of different places. So if you could imagine inside a psychiatric hospital, people think of a lot of times with mental illness, especially that acute mental illness that goes beyond what happens in an outpatient setting. We almost think of, you know, the people are different. The people are like you and I. You would
right.
see a bunch of people of all kinds of different races, ages, creeds, a lot of people that are professionals, all the way down to people that are unemployed. You see people that you normally wouldn't even think would be in a psychiatric hospital. We've treated celebrities, we've treated athletes, we've treated doctors, mm-hmm. lawyers, mm-hmm. teachers, you know, all kinds of people in there. And basically it would look and feel similar to a medical hospital, but there wouldn't be all the equipment there.
Right.
And patients are not in their bedrooms. They spend very little time in their bedrooms. Bedrooms are for sleeping, going to the bathroom, and that's pretty much it. Most part, they'd be in group rooms having group therapy. They'd be eating during meal times. They would be doing some activity therapy. We try to keep them very, very active. So you would see people moving around a lot, people interacting with the staff, talking to doctors, social workers, that type of thing. So it really isn't as mystical. I always say, you know, if you have something in your mind that's really fanciful, you'd probably be disappointed if you walked in.
Right.
You'd see some very interesting people, but it wouldn't be as wild and crazy as a lot of people might imagine mm-hmm. it would be. There's moments where it's very interesting, but a lot of times it's just, you know, that therapy happening. And a very important part of the inpatient piece is safety. That's our number one job, above all. Even if we're not able to apply the right treatments or the medications or anything like that, safety is number one. So there's a lot of effort that's put into keeping the environment safe. Right now, there's a really big push by the Joint Commission, and that's the agency, of course, that gives us the stamp of approval that we can do the business that we do, for what they call anti-ligature. And ligature is really the term to describe how someone might hang themselves. You know, we're acutely aware that a person at their lowest point in their life may want to harm themselves.
Right.
And our job is to make sure that they don't do that while they're with us. So making sure that there's no point at which you can tie anything off and harm yourself, making sure there's no objects that you can mm-hmm. harm yourself with, making sure that, and that includes things like shoelaces and belts and that type of thing.
Right.
But really, the main part is just attending to all of our patients and watching them, you know, keeping track of them, making sure that at every given moment that they're okay, so that mm-hmm. we can respond if there's any type of a problem. So, you know, the inside of a psychiatric hospital, I always welcome people to visit that are allowed to visit, that are mm-hmm. It's appropriate to visit, but always keeping in mind that privacy has to outweigh everything yes. else.
Well, let's talk about the treatment that happens there.
Sure.
I think you've mentioned the psychiatrist, mm-hmm. you mentioned group therapy. Mm-hmm. Maybe it'd be helpful to maybe go through a day. If I'm a patient, go through a day of treatment, typical day.
Well, it's funny because when you look and you think of the scheduling, you think, well, how can you fill a day? You'd be surprised that mm-hmm. you actually get to the point where you say, we don't have time to do anything
right.
more.
And lots of times in medical, there's when you're in for medical, there's some periods of boredom
yeah.
where you're just,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
But it sounds like that doesn't happen.
That really doesn't happen. By the time it's bedtime, if we've done our job well, they're exhausted.
Mm-hmm. So let's go through a day of treatment.
Sure, sure. So you wake up, and you're waking up relatively early. I mean, for a lot of people, it would be, you know, 6, 6:30 in the morning.
Okay.
You might get your morning medication. That's a big process because right. pretty much everybody who's in the hospital, with very few exceptions, are going to be on some medication, sometimes several. A lot of that's medical medications that they may have taken, sure. you know, statins for blood pressure, you know, and cholesterol and that type of thing. And then there's the psychiatric medication. So you wake up, you go through that process, you get yourself dressed, take a shower if that's the time that you choose to take a shower. You're going to go and eat, have a nice meal. That's something we're working on, really improving the quality of our food. And you're going to do morning groups. And that's going to be really a community meeting type of group where a lot of the treatment that we do involves people connecting with other people. So it's setting goals for the day. It's understanding what are your worries, what are your concerns, what are the things that can hold you back for that particular day. It involves even things like morning stretches and just taking a little time to talk about what's going on in the world and the news and the things that might be bothering us. And then you'd be going into a long list of different groups.
Okay.
With very short breaks in between. I mean, like maybe 5-10 minutes to go to the restroom or collect yourself. So these would be groups that would be social work groups. Some would be nursing groups where they might talk about nursing topics, medication awareness, physical ailments. Mm-hmm. You know, you do find that with mental health comes a lot of physical pieces as well, and not just right. side effects to medications, but
right.
you know, when the mind isn't working, the body stops working as well. So you're going to see your doctors during that time and really going to be either pulled out of groups or in those in-between times
right.
where you'll see a medical doctor, like a primary care physician.
Yeah.
You would go to more groups that involve, recreation activity therapists. It might be a music group, some more lighthearted fun groups, some groups mm-hmm. that teach coping skills. Then, you know, as part of the day and interspersed in between might be time for you to make some phone calls and to reconnect and then spend some time with your social worker. You know, a lot of time is spent. The social work piece is a very big part of it. Now, by training, I am that, so that's where a lot of my focus ends up being. Yeah. But in reality, you know, from the moment you walk into a psychiatric hospital, we're looking at what's going to happen when you leave. So we're talking about setting up the appropriate aftercare. We're talking about what kind of resources you have, where are you going to live. Things that you might not even think of become very big pieces. You know, can you pay your rent? Are your bills up to speed? Do you have a pet at home that we need to attend to and find a way to take care of? You know, what about your job? Do they need to hear that you've been in a hospital, and how can we navigate around that without disclosing any more information than we have to? You know, what's going on in that outside world, and what kind of therapy, treatment, and follow-up are you going to need? Because it's really important to remember that a psychiatric hospital is a piece of a continuum. You don't come in, receive your treatment, go out, and then you're done. You come in, receive your treatment, and then you need the follow-up. Without the follow-up, the recidivism rate and the success rate just falls off the map. It becomes, you know, negligible. So setting up that follow-up is extraordinarily important, and we spend a lot of time doing that. Yeah. And it's not just making appointments. It's right. Understanding all the dynamics that go into a person's life and trying to pull those in together. So there, you know, you have the appointments, but then you have the other pieces. So that takes a lot of time. And then you're going to go through more groups, and you're going to, you know, then have your other meals. And by the time we're done with all of our groups, you look at the clock, it's nighttime, around 9 o'clock at night, you're bushed, time to go to bed. You know, we deal with adults, so if they want to stay up a little later, that's absolutely fine. But for the most part, by that time, it's been such an active day that it's time to lay your head on the pillow and get ready for the next. Mm-hmm.
As an outpatient psychotherapist, one of the things I appreciate when people come out, you know, they usually bring their discharge summary with them. Mm-hmm. And what a lot of these folks need and what they need to learn is coping skills.
Yes, yes.
And the groups are great for that. And they generally come out with what coping skills work for them and what kind of stressors. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the group modality is great for that, I think. Something that when I do individual outpatient, I don't do a lot of groups. So
yeah.
I think that's very good. People coming out and, you know, okay, I was in the psychiatric hospital, but here's the things I can do, so maybe I don't need to go back.
That's right.
And I think one of the things you look at or your organization looks at is recidivism. How often do they come back? But before we get into that, let's talk about how someone gets to Haven, for instance. What are the avenues? If there's a viewer out there and they say, I think I have a family member or whatever. So what is the process? Why don't you share that?
Sure. Well, some psychiatric hospitals, you can go up and knock on their door if you need to. Okay. We're at this point not set up that way. We're moving towards that model. So hopefully by the end of the year, we'll be at a point where we'll have a full intake center, and we'll be able to take what, you know, in the business we refer to as walk-ins. And walk-ins aren't necessarily that you drive up and come in, usually family members taking you or you're referred by a professional. As it is today, how you get into us is by some contact with a professional. So that might be a crisis worker if you know someone is in acute crisis. For the most part, self-referral, somebody saying, I really need to go into the hospital. That doesn't usually happen in a pure sense. Most of the time, it's somebody identifying and saying, you know, Jim, we need to go and see the doctor. We need to call the doctor. And most of the time, it ends up with an emergency room visit of some sort.
Okay.
Sometimes the police are involved. Sometimes a crisis worker is involved. We hope not. Hmm. You know, we prefer to take out that piece. But when necessary, that's there.
Sure.
But a lot of times, it's just someone's loved one or someone that they know or a therapist that might be seeing them for a visit looks and says, we're seeing a decompensation here. And I have to say, that's not terribly different from the way someone enters for a medical reason.
No.
You might see your primary care physician or make a call and say, hey, doc, this is going on, and I'm really worried about it. And he says, go on into the emergency room. We'll follow it up from there. And that starts the whole course of the treatment. So you know, somebody's brought into the emergency room. Most emergency rooms, some smaller ones don't, but most are set up for folks that have mental illness, and they have different rooms that are set up that don't have all the equipment that you normally would need, and a little more supervision just to make sure that that person doesn't make a decision that's going to affect their rest of their life and become impulsive. And they go in there, they receive an evaluation. A psychiatrist might see them, but in most cases, they won't. Most of the time, it's going to be the emergency room physician. Not unlike you go in for a broken arm. That's not an orthopedic doctor that's seeing you. That's an emergency room physician. Their job is to just get you ready for that next level of care for the specialist to take over. And in very much the same way, then they'll make calls to us and say, you know, here's the case. Here's all of the information about this particular person. Here's their story. And then when we would accept, they would take them in an ambulance and bring them over. And it's not lights flashing and all that type of thing. It's just a ride, a safe ride over. They would bring them to us, and then we would take them, welcome them in, and start their treatment.
Okay. And I don't want to get into too much detail, but every now and then when a person doesn't want to go in, sometimes they're forced to go in because they meet a criteria of harm, possible harm to themselves or others, and other times people voluntarily, and most times.
Yes, most of the time it's voluntary.
Yes, so, but then the treatment's about the same.
That's right, it's exactly the same.
No matter how you get there. We have, you know, about 10 minutes left. I'd like to get into some of the other areas that you're interested in. Is there anything else you want to say about Haven before we move on?
I think we covered it.
Okay, good. let's talk about stigma. You know, I've had guests on over the years that talk about that. Why don't you, first of all, explain to the audience what is stigma and how it relates to mental health?
Sure. Well, stigma is it's a deadly phenomenon. And I mean that in the literal sense. Stigma is that embarrassment that comes, that judgmental quality of having an illness. Mental illness is one of the only sets, and maybe nowadays it is the only set of illnesses that you're not allowed to have in our society. Mm-hmm. There's a judgment that goes beyond anything else. You know, we do call ourselves behavioral medicine, and I wish we wouldn't, because behavioral medicine implies that it's a choice. You know, and the judgment that comes out of implying that it's a choice is very difficult to overcome, because unless you've experienced it, it's very hard to empathize. You know, I think of the medical field. So somebody comes into the emergency room, they have a compound fracture. They have the bone sticking out of their leg. It's horrible. They're not going to be on their best behavior at that moment. They might be cursing. They might be screaming. They might be writhing in pain. They might say things that they would never say in any other situation. We don't judge them for that.
Right.
We understand it. We look at it. We're genetically wired to see that and think of what that might feel like if that was us. And so we allow it, we forgive it, and we just brush it off. We can't see that in mental illness, though. We can't see the bipolar part of your brain.
There's no obvious bone.
Exactly. There's no obvious bone. So we can't empathize in a way and say, I know what it feels like to not be able to get out of bed. Mm-hmm. I know what it feels like to be in a bipolar manic state and have absolutely no control over my own mind. I know what it feels like to have, you know, be hearing voices and to be, you know, completely unable to communicate with other people because this is really overtaking my mind. It's a very physical thing up there, but we can't see it. So we don't have that empathy. So that relates into how we treat the people that have those issues. So we talk about stigma a lot. You know, a lot of people talk about it, and awareness is super important. We have to be aware of it. You can't attack anything unless you're aware. But the way I see it as well is, once we get past that awareness, what do you do with it? It has to come down to action. What are you doing to stop the stigma? For us, it's creating an environment that is judgment-free. It's not that easy to do. You know, you hire staff, and a lot of your staff have not experienced this. But it all starts with a mindset, and for us, you know, I always say, every one of us, you, me, everyone in this room, everybody who's watching here, we are all one bad day away from needing to be in a hospital ourselves. We are not above it because we hold the keys as staff. We're not better people. We are not better at life because we're on this side of it. Today I'm treating you. Tomorrow you may be treating me. It's no different than physical medicine in that way. So remembering that, you know, this is not something that anybody asked for. It's not something they control. You cannot get rid of mental illness by sheer will any more than you can get rid of diabetes. And for me, helping people understand that correlation, because we can all relate to the physical piece, but understanding that it really is no different, and to put aside the judgments and to put aside all of the things that we do that stop people from getting treatment, because what mm-hmm. happens is people understand that, you know, in their own minds, that this person is able to stop doing what they're doing if they really wanted to, and if they had the right motivation, and if I get in their face enough, they're going to stop doing this. And that turns into behavior that ends up with, you know, we have patients that will go to a pharmacy and turn around and not get their prescriptions filled because they have a neighbor that works as a pharmacy tech there and they don't mm-hmm. want them to see what they're on. We have patients that will not go, you know, we'll set them up for treatment and they will not go into the treatment center because the front door is in public and someone's going to drive by and see that they're going in there.
Right.
It has to be done almost through the cover of night. Now, that's not every patient,
right.
But especially for people new into the system, they're embarrassed that they're receiving treatment.
Right.
Well, would you be embarrassed to, you know, be on insulin for diabetes?
Right.
No, of course not. It's not your fault. And even if something is your fault, you know, somebody, you know, gets lung cancer from smoking, we still don't judge them that way. They have lung cancer, we're going to treat them. We're going to treat them compassionately. So it starts with making sure that we provide compassionate care within the facility.
Right.
And then getting the word out individually to each person that we can, that this is something that, thereby the grace of God go I, it could be me, and it could be you. And for some of our staff, it has been them. And for people that you know, we see in the community, we know it has been them. So treating them like we would treat any other medical illness. And, you know, that's where we see it from our end. And then it goes into, you know, the outpatient world and the general population, the community. And hopefully it can spread if we hit one person at a time and help them understand that empathy.
Right. It's important to remember that mental health isn't, mental illness isn't due to a moral deficiency.
Absolutely. I'm glad you said that.
I think that's, and that's, of course, that's historically.
Yes.
That was believed.
Yes.
So.
And still believed today by a lot of people, even though they might claim that it's not.
Right.
A lot of people see someone with mental illness and they think that they are somehow a broken person morally, that they've done something to deserve this.
Right. We only have about 3 minutes. Let's talk about, I know that you've been put on the suicide prevention task force for the county.
Mm-hmm.
What can you say about suicide in 3 minutes, right?
Well,
let's talk about, you know.
Sure. Suicide is a plague. You know, in America, in inpatient facilities, 5 people a day commit suicide. Even though we go through extensive lengths to try and prevent that, 5 people a day, that is horrible. So for us, our piece is, you know, we're looking at people in having their worst day of their lives, having the worst set of days in their lives, and making sure that they don't make an impulsive decision that is going to, you know, end their lives and touch a whole lot of people, making sure that they survive their bout with mental illness. So suicide for us is, you know, no different than a death in a cardiac unit for someone else. It's not going to happen on my watch. It's not going to happen in our facility. That has to be the mantra that we take. So our focus is really on that and going out and helping people understand that the stigma affects suicide rates and that, you know, not receiving treatment and barriers to treatment affect suicide, and trying to prevent it by really taking action, not just making people aware. Awareness is great. It's important. But making sure that we're taking action so that we break down the barriers so that people can get treatment, so they don't feel embarrassed to get treatment, so they're not looked down on society to get treatment. So, you know, my involvement in the task force is very new, but I love the things that they're doing that are very bold and very effective at getting the word out and really correlating and bringing that back to that stigma piece. That if we can make mental illness no different than any physical illness, and it deserves to be, then we can save lives.
Yeah. Thank you. We're talking to Bob Scheffler. He is the CEO of Haven Behavioral Hospital here in Reading. thank you so much for being my guest.
And, thank you for having me.
I just get the idea that maybe there's another show with you in the future, because we certainly didn't get to cover everything. But it's we just welcome you to our community and look forward to working with you.
Thank you. I'm privileged to be here.
This is Jim Miller, and this has been Talking Mental Health. We'll see you next time.
Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.